God, loves me. I have sinned. Jesus died on the cross for me. I need to decide to live for God.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior, for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again, with life and liberty to all who believe.
What is rule number one? You guys almost said it, didn't you? Yeah. Well, so I have a few announcements for us to go over before we get things kicked off too much this evening. First of all, our plan moving forward consists of running the buses only when the schools open back up again. If we're unable to do that for the rest of this season due to our social distancing restrictions, we have another plan, and that is to have two fun days during the summer. One fun day at the end of June and another fun day at the end of August. Now, what are those fun days going to consist of, you might ask? A bouncy house, water fights, maybe color war, maybe money machine, maybe a dunk tank. We don't know, but whatever it's going to be a blast because it's going to be outside and the weather is going to be beautiful. So stay tuned for our future plans in that. We are trying to plan some really cool things for us for this summer. Okay, now in regards to our normal announcements, let's go into our Power Seat Prize. A little bit different on how we earn our Power Seat Prize now, wouldn't you say? But hey, I want you guys to take a look at those cheese balls. We've got four things of those cheese balls that need to be given to you guys before the close of this season, because we don't want those to go bad and go to waste. We want to make sure we get them out to you. So for those who click like, share, comment, what have you, on our YouTube videos, Facebook feed, and all that kind of stuff, you will win those cheese balls. They will be yours, and we will be out to give them to you. Okay, everybody, so I want you to sit back, relax, and enjoy the rest of the video.
Hey, Ducktape Kelly!
What? Bucky! What are you doing?
Well, for Faith Kidz this week, don't look behind my back. You can't see it yet because I'm not showing you.
Okay.
We're talking about the Shield of Faith. And Sparky's not here. Or wait, Bucky's not here. Who am I?
You're Bucky.
Okay, Sparky's not here. And I don't know where he is. Oh, but the Shield of Faith.
I guess that's why I'm here.
Why are you here?
Because Sparky's not here.
What's your name?
Ducktape.
Oh, yeah. See that guy? He's a mannequin.
Are you sure?
He's a mannequin. Yeah. And he's got the breastplate of righteousness on him.
Excellent.
And the American flag and a backpack. And the shoes of the gospel of peace.
Excellent.
And the belt of truth. And he has a head full of hair.
He does.
You know what else he doesn't have?
What?
He does not have a Shield of Faith. You want to know how I know?
Why? How?
I got it right here.
Oh, it's right there.
He didn't even know I had it. Because you can't see it.
Are you sure?
You can't see it. It's invisible.
Oh.
Watch. Now you see me. And you still do. Okay. He moved that arm by himself.
He did. I'm
sorry.
Should we test it?
So now he can go. He can go through all of life's obstacles completely protected because he has a shield of faith.
So if I throw this at him, it'll protect him.
All he does is laugh, but he didn't get hurt. All
right.
So here's what we gotta do. We have to send him on a mission.
Yeah.
With the shield of faith to make sure he doesn't get hurt.
Okay.
He's gonna take this everywhere he goes in life. Okay?
Oh, yeah. He'll never get hurt.
So, okay, mannequin.
Systems activated.
What?
Activate.
What?
What do you want me to do?
I was gonna pretend that you did stuff. Are you alive?
I'm a robot.
No, you're not a robot. You're alive.
He's a mannequin.
I have a computer inside of me.
You work for Bill Gates?
No.
Okay, well, let's see what you can do. I would like you to go get in that truck over there. Yeah. Mix some concrete.
Okay.
Yeah. See what? He can do.
Oh, you almost tripped.
What's the problem?
I can't make through.
Why?
Too short of an entrance.
That's the only problem. I hear you. Okay, well, forget about it. What else do we have? See, the shield of faith has protected him from the danger that lies ahead over there. There could be an evil raccoon, and it won't let him go near. Let's have him get in that tractor.
Yeah.
And go harvest the field.
Okay.
This is going to be great.
Yay!
There he goes. Fully protected and everything. Totally righteous in all the things he does. Except for nobody taught the robot how to go upstairs. What's the problem?
I can't make it up the stairs.
Is it because your legs are made out of metal?
No.
Is it because you're wearing a fireman's pants?
No.
Is it because you just simply weren't programmed right?
No.
What's the problem? Okay, come back here. I know what the problem is. The problem is, there's no problem. The shield of faith
is protecting him.
It's simply protecting him from a madman inside the tractor that was going to kill him.
Yeah.
What else should we have him do?
Welcome to another edition of the Bible. It's Alive. Today, we turn our attention to the faith-filled voyage of Paul. Paul is a prisoner among many others who are awaiting their trials in Rome. Let's watch this video to really understand the faith of Paul as they crossed very stormy waters.
Shipwrecked, Part 1. For many days, neither the sun nor the stars appeared, while the storm continued to rage, until gradually all hope of survival vanished. Acts 27:20. Paul was a religious leader in Jerusalem who didn't believe Yeshua was the Messiah. He did everything he could to hurt Yeshua's followers and to put them in prison. But after God spoke to Paul on the road to Damascus, Paul's life changed forever. From then on, he traveled from place to place, teaching the scriptures and telling people about Yeshua. But the other religious leaders in Jerusalem didn't believe Yeshua was the promised Messiah like Paul now did. Paul was one of us, and now he's teaching lies, they said to each other. We must stop him. Paul was arrested and put into prison. The religious leaders wanted Paul to stand trial for teaching lies, but Paul knew he had done nothing wrong. Caesar will decide if I stand trial, not these religious leaders, he told Festus, the governor of Judea. Paul was a Roman citizen, so Festus agreed to send him to Rome.
You have appealed to Caesar. Then to Caesar you go.
He handed Paul and some other prisoners over to a Roman officer named Julius. It was Julius's job to take the prisoners to Rome by ship. He stood on the deck and counted the men. 1, 2, 3, 4.
I don't want you jumping overboard and swimming away, he told them.
The ship left Caesarea and sailed towards the port of Mura. Below deck, the prisoners crowded together and talked about Paul.
I heard they sent hundreds of soldiers to arrest him, one man said. He must be a real troublemaker.
Luckily, Paul is a Roman citizen, another said. Otherwise, the religious leaders would have ordered him to die.
The prisoners nodded their heads. Everyone in Jerusalem knew the religious leaders hated Paul because he taught that Yeshua was the Messiah. At the port of Mura, Julius strode up and down the wharf inspecting the ships. It was nearly winter time and the seas were becoming rough. Julius frowned at the dark gray clouds.
I need to find a bigger ship, he said.
A grain freighter would be safer and faster than the small boat they had arrived on from Caesarea.
I have a group of soldiers and prisoners,
Julius shouted up to the ship's crews.
Does anyone have room on their freighter?
We have space, said a captain.
He hurried down the gangplank to meet Julius. Julius bought tickets for the journey and marched Paul and the prisoners onto the ship. The captain wanted to leave Mura quickly. There were food shortages in Rome, and Caesar had offered lots of money to people who delivered grain during the dangerous winter months.
Untie the ropes, he ordered. We're sailing to Rome.
The ship left Mura and sailed across the Mediterranean Sea toward Rome. But the weather changed and the winds began to blow harder and harder. Paul and Julius stood on the deck and stared at the sky.
I don't like the look of those clouds, said Julius.
The ship crawled through the water as slow as a snail.
The wind is too strong,
the captain shouted to the sailors.
Let's sail towards the coast of Crete and find shelter from the storm.
More clouds rolled across the sky, and the winds blew even harder. No matter how hard the sailors worked, they couldn't sail the ship any faster. A few days later, the ship crept into Fair Haven Harbor on the island of Crete. Paul rolled up his sleeping mat and strode over to the captain. It's already past Yom Kippur, he warned. If we sail on, this trip will end in disaster. The captain and sailors didn't listen to Paul's warning.
Leave it to us to sail this ship. We know what we're doing.
If we stay in the harbor, we can avoid the winter storms, argued Paul. Why don't we leave for Rome when the seas are calm? But the captain had made up his mind.
Tomorrow we sail to Phoenix. We can stay there for the winter if the weather is bad.
Paul sighed and shook his head. He feared the captain had made the wrong decision. Part 2. With the wind in its sails, the ship sailed out into the Mediterranean Sea. The captain stood at the back of the boat, his hands on an oar.
Don't worry, he told Paul. I've made the right decision. We'll be in Phoenix by tomorrow morning.
But as the ship sailed towards Phoenix, the winds turned into howling gales. Paul gripped the railings and watched the black clouds roll toward the ship. Oh, we're heading for trouble, he thought. The crew stared up at the clouds in horror. They had seen this kind of weather before. The ship was sailing into the path of a deadly storm. Monster waves began pounding the ship.
Quick! Pull up the lifeboat and the oars!
The captain commanded.
The sailors dragged the lifeboat onto the deck and tied the oars to the sides. They lowered the sails from the masts and wrapped rope around the ship to hold it together. Winds tore across the bow and waves crashed over the ship.
If the storm continues, the ship may sink,
cried the captain. The sailors' hearts pounded with fear. They didn't want to drown at sea. They tied themselves to the masts and held on tight. The next morning, the captain made a decision.
The ship is too heavy,
he shouted.
Throw the cargo overboard.
Quickly, Paul and the prisoners grabbed heavy sacks of corn and grain and dumped them into the water.
Throw the rigging overboard,
yelled the sailors. They tossed the ropes and chains into the sea. Thunder boomed overhead and lightning streaked across the sky. The ship was now at the mercy of the wind and the waves.
We're all doomed,
the sailors cried. They were too seasick to steer the ship.
We'll never make it to Rome alive.
Paul struggled to his feet and stood in front of the shivering men. If you had listened to me and stayed in the harbor at Crete, we wouldn't be in this mess. The men lay on the deck, clutching their stomachs. They were too sick to eat or say a word. But don't worry, said Paul. He turned to the captain. An angel from God told me I must stand before the Roman Emperor. This ship will be driven ashore onto an island, but God will save us. The captain clung to the mast of the swaying ship and nodded his head.
Oh, I hope Paul is right, he muttered. Anything is better than sailing through this terrible storm.
He needed the sun and the stars to steer the ship, but thick black clouds covered the sky. The crew began to give up hope of ever being saved. Part 3. On the 14th night, the day before the Feast of Tabernacles, the men heard a strange noise. Was that the sound of waves crashing on rocks? They jumped to their feet and stared into the darkness. A sailor tossed a measuring rope over the side to see how deep the water was.
120 feet deep,
he yelled. A little further, he dropped the rope again.
90 feet deep!
The crew threw their hands in the air and cheered. They were near land. Maybe they wouldn't drown after all. Worried the ship would smash into the rocks, the captain shouted,
drop the anchors! We'll stay here until dawn!
The sailors pushed the four anchors overboard, and the ship came to a shuddering stop. The captain breathed a sigh of relief. Phew. His boat was safe. Some of the sailors were tired of feeling sick and wanted to go home. They came up with a clever plan. Let's take one of the lifeboats and row ashore, they whispered to each other. Quietly lowered a lifeboat down to the water. Paul saw what the sailors were doing and pulled Julius aside. If those sailors escape, you have no hope of being saved, said Paul. Tell your soldiers to stop them. The Roman soldiers grabbed their swords and cut the ropes to the lifeboat.
How will we get home now?
The sailors complained. They sat in the lifeboat and scowled at the soldiers. Just before dawn, Paul gathered the men together on the deck. Please, eat something, he told them. You need to stay strong. Remember that God promised to save your lives. No one will die. The men's stomachs grumbled loudly. Nobody had eaten for days, and they were as hungry as wolves. Paul took some bread, blessed it, and began to eat. As dawn broke, the men finally saw land. They stared silently at the sandy beach across the bay.
See that strip of sand?
The captain told the sailors. He pointed to the sandy beach.
Steer the ship towards that shore.
The sailors quickly obeyed. They cut off the anchors and untied the oars, and the ship lurched forward through the crashing waves. Crunch! The ship crashed into a rocky reef, just as the captain had feared, and began to tear apart on the rocks.
Let's get out of here!
The sailors cried. Arms spinning like windmills, the men swam toward the beach as fast as they could. The Roman soldiers said to Julius,
"Kill the prisoners so they don't escape."
But Julius shook his head. No! I must save Paul's life. He must stand before Caesar in Rome. One by one, Paul and the prisoners dived into the sea and swam across the bay to the sandy beach. They were tired of this watery adventure, and they couldn't wait to reach dry land. Just as God had promised, Paul and the men reached the shore safely. They had arrived on the island of Malta. The people of Malta wanted to help the men. They collected pieces of wood and made a huge bonfire so everyone could get warm. The men crowded around the fire, laughing and stamping their feet. Oh, they were happy to be warm and dry again. Paul was pleased to be on dry land for the Feast of Tabernacles. He quietly thanked God for saving the men's lives. As Paul warmed himself by the fire, a poisonous snake slithered towards him and bit him on the hand.
"This man must be a murderer," cried the locals. "He survived the shipwreck, but he won't survive this snake bite."
The people watched Paul to see what would happen, but Paul tossed the snake into the fire without being hurt. Everyone shook their heads in amazement.
"This man must be a god," they said. "How else could he still be alive?"
Poplios, the governor of Malta, gave the men a place to stay. When Paul found out that Poplios' father was sick, Paul prayed and asked God to heal the man. After this, many people came to Paul to be healed. Everyone treated him with respect and gave him many gifts. After 3 months, the captain was eager to leave. He found another ship and summoned his sailors.
"We're leaving for Rome."
The captain hadn't forgotten about Paul and the prisoners.
"Get your men ready,"
he told Julius. Paul hurried down to the dock with the prisoners and boarded the ship. He had enjoyed helping the people of Malta, but God wanted him in Rome. It was time to stand before Caesar, the mighty Roman Emperor.
This was a great demonstration of Paul's faith. He knew that he was to sail to Rome. Along the way, they ran into some very bad storms. Paul told the men that there would be no loss of life, but only the ship. Paul knew this because an angel of God told him that he would stand before Caesar in Rome. Our scripture verse for this week comes out of two different scriptures. The first one comes out of Romans chapter 10, verse 17, and it says, "Faith comes by hearing the word of God." And out of Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Our PowerPoint this week is that I will walk by faith and not by sight. Even Denzel Washington said that, and he's one of the greatest actors ever. Okay, let's say this all together. I walk by faith and not by sight. All right, guys, I want you to kick back and enjoy the rest of the video.
Hey, Uncle Larry! I got out of my box hole! Oh, what's going on with my head?
Box hole, get over here!
What?
Get over here!
What?
What are you doing? My natural foxhole! Right there! Frank!
Big hole!
Frank!
Yeah!
This is not a war zone!
No, it's not!
This is the firing range!
Oh!
Look down there about 800 yards. See those white things?
Oh, I
I say must be going. I didn't mean 800 yards, it's about 80 yards. You see? I carefully place white targets.
Okay. Yeah, I do.
Okay. What we're gonna do is we're gonna shoot those targets.
Okay?
Have you been brushing up on your firearms skills, Voxel?
Not lately. I've been more digging.
Well, put the shovel down mentally.
Okay.
And I will hand you your weapon. Okay. Now, here's what we're gonna do.
Okay.
Well, first, did you bring hearing protection?
I'm good.
How about eye protection?
Well, you know, I got those.
Okay. Well, you see all those targets?
Yeah.
We're not out here for the fun of it.
Okay.
We're teaching a valuable lesson.
A lesson?
Yeah. Those are people. You see that? Let's pretend all those white targets are people.
Okay.
They're not the enemy, Frank.
No.
They're innocent people. I think. Does that sound right? Yes. Because what we're simulating here is how the fiery darts of the enemy are constantly being shot at us.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
So, there you are on a hillside one day, and fiery darts come your way.
Okay.
And I can't think of a better way to illustrate a fiery dart than my AR-15.
Oh, wow.
At nighttime, there would be fire behind said dart.
That'd be okay? Awesome.
Now, do you remember your firing position?
Yeah.
Well, Frank, I want you to shoot one of those targets.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. Are you ready?
All right.
Okay. Now, you want me to plug your ears?
I'm good.
Are you good?
I'm good.
Okay, I'm going to plug mine. You shoot one, then I'll shoot one.
All right.
And we're going to see what happens when you have no protection.
Okay.
So if the enemy shoots a fiery dart at you, then you have no protection. Heck, they're not even in a foxhole. They're just out in the open. I'm curious to see what would happen.
Yeah, me too.
All right.
All right.
Let's begin.
Okay.
Fire, soldier. Holy moly.
Did I hit it?
Nope. That was a direct hit.
Where?
In fact, it flew like 5 feet in the air. Let's do it again.
Okay.
Wow. Fiery dart number two was a direct hit.
Nice.
Correct. Now, both of those targets have exploded upon impact. Okay? That's called killed in action.
Yeah.
And worse than that, dead on arrival.
Oh, man.
But, come here, Frank. Come here.
Yeah.
Some of those targets there actually have a shield in front of them.
Yeah.
Yes, they do. So we already know what happens when the fiery darts of the enemy are shot at you and you have no shield. You explode!
Yeah.
But what happens if you are a person that is full of faith? You have the shield of faith. That's what we're talking about. The shield of faith.
Yeah.
What if the shield of faith is in front of you and the enemy shoots a fiery dart at you? What if a whole battalion shoots a bunch of fiery darts at you?
Hopefully it bounce off.
I would like to see what happens. So let's give them all we got. Let's shoot everything we got at the one that has the shield of faith and see what happens.
Okay.
Let's do it. So foxhole. Now what we have
without a shield of faith, sitting in the open. And then we have a few people behind a shield of faith.
Oh, yeah? Yeah.
So let's shoot at all of them with our fiery darts. All
right.
And see which ones survive.
Okay.
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. Well, why don't you shoot at the one hiding in the bushes? And I'll shoot at the big one. That way, I might have a chance of hitting one.
Okay.
After you, sir.
Oh, after me.
If I will. Hearing protection.
Have you ever walked across an old rickety bridge? I have, and I questioned every step. However, I did it right after I watched somebody else go before me. I knew that it would be perfectly safe. This short video clip that we're going to watch takes us on an adventure of a man who's walking across a bridge that cannot even be seen. So grab some popcorn and enjoy.
You must hurry! Come quickly!
It's a leap of faith. The world.
You must believe, boy. You must believe.
Did you notice the amount of faith that he had to walk across something that was initially unseen? Would you do that? This is what faith in Jesus Christ is all about. We can trust him even though we cannot see it. Just like in our Bible lesson when Paul knew that they would be okay in the shipwreck. Remember, our PowerPoint today is, I will walk by faith and not by sight. So say that with me one more time. I will walk by faith and not by sight.
You know, God has not left us without a defense. In fact, this week we learned about the shield of faith, but a few weeks ago we learned about the belt of truth and how God girds our belly to keep our pants up with a belt of truth. And then he gave us shoes to preach the gospel of peace. And in the world we live in today, peace is a premium. And if you have peace, you have a lot more than most of the people that are around you. You know, he also gave us the breastplate of righteousness. And it isn't our righteousness either. It's the righteousness that Jesus walked in. And he gave us that when he died on the cross for us. And as we talk about the shield of faith, and you know, right now we have people that are so scared of the coronavirus and that's going around. But God has given us a shield to protect us and heal us. Even if we get the virus, we are protected. And all we have to do is trust him and believe that he has equipped us with everything we need. And Jesus said that to those who believe, they will receive his righteousness and his armor. And and when you receive, and when you believe in him and receive his gifts, you are safe. You have peace and joy. And if you've never done that, if you've never asked him into your heart, and you've never believed that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and for my sins, and if you've never done that before, but you do today, would you stand with me and pray? Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you that you walked in righteousness, that you walked in peace, and you walked in joy, and you walked in faith. And we thank you that you are the one who delivers us from all evil, and you protect us. And we ask you, Lord, that you would come into our hearts, into my heart, and be my Lord, and be my Savior. And help me to walk with you and serve you all my life. And all the Faith Kidz said, amen.
What do you want to do? Do a backflip.
Can't.
Why?
Wasn't made for that.
The shield of faith is simply protecting him from breaking his back.
Sure.
What else should we have him do? Climb a power pole. Climb a power pole. Oh, hi, Bubba.
Oh,
we're just enjoying your
farm to do here.
We're having a mannequin. He's all kinds of farm work. With the shield of faith.
Yeah. That isn't the shield of faith.
It's the only one I found, and it's invisible.
Well, yeah, it's a shield. It's a windshield. It keeps bugs out of your teeth when you're driving down the road. But it doesn't keep the enemy or unseen things from getting to you. You see, the shield of faith is unseen totally. And it comes from your heart when you believe in Jesus Christ. And when you receive him into your heart and you ask his protection and covering over you.
So, it doesn't have to be a big obscene windshield that's actually truly invisible?
It's truly invisible, but you'll know it because you'll see people getting hurt on this side and blown out of the water on that side, and you'll see that you're protected. You're surrounded. You're covered front, back, up, down by your shield of faith that God has given you. And all you have to do is believe and speak it. Speak that you have a shield of faith and thank Him for it.
So, if he wasn't carrying this windshield around, but he's a Christian, he still has an invisible shield of faith?
That's right. So do you, and so do you.
I do?
Yeah. If you believe.
I do believe.
Huh?
I do believe.
Well, then you have it.
I already have it. So it keeps me safe?
It keeps you safe, it keeps you healthy, it keeps you...
What if I fall in a volcano?
Stay away from volcanoes. That, you know...
Oh, that's probably the first key.
Yes, that is. It's just a good thinking thing.
Well, so if we take this away from him...
Yeah.
He still has a shield of faith?
He does.
You still see it?
Yeah.
Hey, robot.
Yes.
Are you a Christian?
Yes.
Do you think you have a shield of faith?
Yes.
Do you know karate? The
system hasn't programmed that yet.
So, can you do a backflip now?
No.
So he's just kind of a scared robot, but he has a shield of faith. Which means it will protect him from what?
It'll protect him from the fiery darts that the enemy throws at him. It says he ain't any good, he's worthless, he's a loser, he's a flunky. It'll protect him from disease that you can't see. It'll protect him from all the things that people might say to him that isn't true. It'll keep him going straight and narrow and forward and accomplishing God's will in his life.
So it'll help him be a true Christian.
Yeah.
I like it. Well, perfect. I'm going to exercise my shield of faith every day. And I can't wait to see what we give the mannequin next week. A helmet to cover that hair.
Yay!
All right, turn him off. Push him over.
I'm sure, dog.
Perfect.